In virtualization space, basic scheduling unit is virtual machine. And in container space, it is container. So in Kubernetes, what is a basic scheduling unit? Hello and welcome to Pods. My name is Srinath Challa. I'm a certified Kubernetes administrator. So in next few minutes, I'll try my best to get you up to speed on what are pods in Kubernetes and what is the difference between container and a pod and how to create pods in Kubernetes. Before you watch this video, it is required to have a basic understanding of what is Kubernetes and its basic architecture. In case if you need help with that, then please do check the links in the description below. So, without any further delay, let's take a look at the things you will be learning as part of this video. In this video, we'll primarily focus on discussing the concepts around pods. First, we'll start with discussing what is a pod. Then, we'll discuss how pods are deployed in Kubernetes. After that, we'll see in what instances we will use multiple containers in single pod. Then, we'll look at how does the pod networking works. And after that, we'll discuss about what is inter-pod networking and what is the intra-pod networking. Then, we'll look at the various stages of pod lifecycle. And finally, we'll look at how to write pod manifest file. So, this video is pretty much packed with the concepts around pods. And it is very important to understand all these concepts very well. Because Kubernetes revolves around pods. So it's very important to get the basics straight and then it will help us to build related concepts easily on top of it. And let's get started with discussing what is a pod. So, what is a pod? Pod is an atomic unit of scheduling in Kubernetes world. So to better understand what this atomic unit of scheduling, we'll have to take a step back and look into some of the familiar topics. They are virtualization and containerization. So when you get into the virtualization world, the atomic unit of scheduling is virtual machine. If you want to deploy any app, then you need to put your code and related config inside the virtual machine and then deploy it. Next, when it comes to the containerization world, generally, you use containers. And in the same way, we use pods in Kubernetes world. Virtual machines, containers, and pods are different runtime environments using which we deploy the application. So at a high level, pods are basic unit of scheduling in Kubernetes. Now, we'll look at how these pods are deployed in next slide. In this slide, we'll go through how the pod is deployed and scaled inside Kubernetes cluster. First, to deploy the pod, we generally write the pod manifest file, which consists of container images that we are able to deploy and submit to the API server on the master node. After that, API server and the scheduler components on master nodes decides and deploys these pods onto appropriate worker nodes. As you can see, inside each pod, there is one container in our deployment. And now, let's take a step back here. Generally, our ultimate aim is to deploy our app in the form of containers that are distributed across a set of worker nodes inside the Kubernetes cluster. However, Kubernetes does not deploy containers directly on the worker nodes. Instead, containers are encapsulated inside a pod. As you can see, there are three instances of the same app running on worker node. As the time passes, users accessing the web app increases and then we need to scale the app as the demand goes up. Now, you need to add additional instances of your web app to share the load. So the question here is, how do you scale this app now? If you are thinking adding new container within the same pod, then answer is no. That's not how we do it. We create new pod altogether with the same app instance. As you can see, we just deployed 5 new instances of our web app running on 5 separate pods on same Kubernetes system. And the second question is, what if the number of users accessing the web app further increases and your current node has no sufficient capacity? Well, then it's time to spin up a new VM and join that new worker node to the cluster. Once it is ready, Kubernetes will start deploying pods onto this new node. From this, there are two takeaway points. First, typically there will be one container per pod. Second, to scale up your app, we need to create more pod instances. Similarly, to scale down, we'll do that by deleting the pods, and we do not interact with containers directly. So that's about the deployment. So far we talked about having one-to-one relationship between pod and containers, but it is possible to have two or more containers inside a pod, and which is a rare scenario. And this is called as multi-container pod. We'll discuss about what is multi-container pod and what are some of the situations that will drive us to use more than one container per pod in next slide. Here is the same diagram which we carried from previous slide with some minor corrections to it. So, in what cases do we use multiple containers inside of one single pod? For sure, not to create another instances of an application. If not, then what? Sometimes you'll come across a scenario where you have a helper container that might be doing some kind of a supporting task for our main web app, such as processing a user entered data or a processing a file uploaded by user or etc. And you want this helper container to live along the side of app container. So in that case, you can have both of these containers part of same pod, so that when a new app container is created, the helper container is also created. And in the same case, when the app container dies, then the helper container also dies, because they are part of same pod. So these two containers can also communicate with each other directly by referencing using a local host, because they share the same network namespace. Plus, they can also easily share the storage space as well. However, multi-pod containers are a rare use case, and we are going to stick with a single container per pod for the rest of the course. So that's about the multi-container. Now let's discuss about the pod networking in next slide. As you can see in this diagram, we are having two pods, pod 1 and pod 2, which are running on worker node inside the cluster. Pod 1 has two containers and pod 2 has just one container. For simplicity purpose, I did not show the node and the cluster explicitly in this diagram. So if you observe this diagram, you will notice something new in this diagram. If your answer is pod IP address, then you're right. As most of us are aware, every node inside the Kubernetes cluster has its unique IP address, which is called as node IP address. But in Kubernetes, there is additional one more IP address, which is called as pod IP address. So once we deploy the pod onto the worker node inside the Kubernetes cluster, it will get its own IP address. So every pod inside a Kubernetes cluster has a unique IP address for that pod. So if you look at the example we got here, we got two pods and two IP addresses, and we have one IP per pod. So how are these containers inside the pod communicate with outside world? And there is something called as network namespace. All these containers inside a pod operate within that same network namespace as a pod, which means all these containers inside the pod will have the same IP address. But there should be one distinct thing which will make the unique way to identify each of these containers. That's where the ports come in. As you can see, the main container in the pod 1 has a port 8080. So it can be accessed using the pod IP and the port number 8080. Similarly, supporting container in pod 1 can access using the same pod IP and the port number 3000. Since these two containers are part of pod 1, so the IPs are same. Now, to access the container inside pod 2, we use the pod 2 IP address and the port number of the container. So that's how we access the applications deployed inside the containers and pods are accessed from the outside world in Kubernetes. And there is one last thing to clarify before we move on to the next slide. And that is, containers within same pod not only just share the same IP address, but it will also share the access to the same volumes, same C group limits, and even same IPC names. And that is something very important to note. So in next slide, we look at how one pod talks to another pod, which is called as inter-pod communication. Now in this slide, we'll discuss how two pods communicate with each other, which is called as inter-pod communication. Inter-pod communication is simple. That's because all the pod IP addresses are fully routable on the pod network inside the Kubernetes cluster. If you have watched me setting up Kubernetes using Kubadium video in this series, which you might have done already, where you have seen me installing pod network plugin, which is called as a flannel, and I have used the CIDR IP ranges to create the pod network. Once you are done with that step, every pod gets its own IP address that's routable within that cluster. This means every pod can directly talk with every other pod, and there is no need to mess with any port mapping or anything. And there is no need to mess with any port mappings or anything. Well, that's about the inter-pod communication in short. And now we are going to talk about how the intra-pod network communication is going to work in the next slide. In this slide, we'll discuss about how two or more containers within say pod communicate, which is also called as intra-pod communication. We have touched this topic in previous slide, where you have two or more containers within the same pod and how do they talk to the outside world. One thing we didn't discuss is how do they communicate within same pod. Well, inside the pod, like if you got a multiple containers in there, they all talk over using shared localhost interface. So all containers can directly communicate with each other's pod on localhost. Within the pod, they all share same IP address and the network namespace. And if you need to make multiple containers available to outside world, which is exposing to the outside world, then you need to expose them on ports. And obviously, if you got a two containers inside a pod, then both cannot use the same port number. Still, normal networking rules apply here. So, speaking at a very high level, containers within same pod communicate inside using a shared local host. So that's about the intra-pod communication. And now, let's see the various stages in the lifecycle of a pod from start to end. In this slide, we'll discuss about the lifecycle of a pod. First, you define the pod configuration inside a manifest file in YAML or JSON format. Most typically, you'll be using the YAML format. Then, you submit the manifest file at the API server on Kubernetes master. And once that is done, it will get scheduled onto a worker node inside the Kubernetes cluster. Once that is scheduled, it goes into the pending state. So during this pending state, node will download all the container images and starts running the containers. It stays in the pending state until all containers are up and running. Once that is done, it goes into the running state. So here in this running state, if the main purpose of the pod is achieved, then it gets shut down and the state changes to the succeeded. And there is one more stage, where the pod gets into the failed state. That happens when the pod is in pending state. If for some reason it won't get started, the pod will move into the failed state. And one last thing to note. When pod dies, it dies. You can't bring that pod back from dead. So if they die, you replace with a new pod. The old one is gone and the shiny new one with exactly the same config but a different ID, different IP and all magically appears and takes its place. So that's about the various pod statuses during its lifecycle. And now it's time to see what goes into the pod manifest file, and we'll see that in next part, which is review demo. Here in this part 2, we'll review the pods demo we are able to perform live on Kubernetes cluster in advance. So this will help you better understand when you watch actually doing it live. So in this review demo, I'll show you what goes inside the pod manifest file. Then we create the pod and we'll display and validate the objects to make sure it has created. And finally, we'll test the pod deployment to make sure it is working as it should be. And now let's get started with creating the pod manifest file. We can define Kubernetes objects in two formats. They are JSON and YAML format. YAML has the cleaner and the most easy to understand than JSON. In our video, we will use the YAML format. So most of the Kubernetes object consists of four top level required fields. So even in the pod manifest file, it contains the same four top level fields. They are API version, kind, metadata, and spec. So you must have them in your configuration file. So let's see what they are. First, API version. API version defines the version number which this Kubernetes object belongs to. So I have made this table which explains about the kind of the object and its respective API version. It's important to remember this relationship, which will help us creating future objects. As you can see, there are different types of API version. So what this means? At a high level, if an API version is V1, then that Kubernetes object is part of first stable release of Kubernetes API. So it contains many of the core objects, which includes pod, replication controller, and service. So all these objects are part of first stable release of Kubernetes API. Then you see another API version, which is apps V1. It is one of the most common API group in Kubernetes. It includes the functionality related to running apps on Kubernetes, like deployments, rolling updates, and replica set. And the final API version in this list is batch V1. The batch API group contains objects related to batch processing and jobs like tasks. So any functionality in Kubernetes starts with alpha, then it moves into the beta, and finally the stable. The stable API version does not contain alpha or beta in their names, as you see above in this list. So they are safe to use. And now let's get back to the pod configuration again. So the API version of pod is V1. Next, the kind of object we are creating here is pod. So pod is here. Next comes the metadata. Metadata section consists of two fields. One is name, other is label. As you guessed it right, name is the name of the object we are creating. In this case, it is the name of the pod, which is Nginx pod. Second, we have labels. Labels are just a tag given to the pod. This labels comes very handy when it comes to filtering. Assume there are thousands of pods running inside your Kubernetes cluster. And now you want to filter all the pods that related to Nginx. Then labels come very handy in those situations. However, label is an optional field, but my personal recommendation is to have labels defined almost always. So far, we have defined about the type and the name of the object we are creating. Next comes the spec. As I mentioned in our pod discussion, pod is nothing but a wrapper around one or more containers. So pod consists of one or more containers. And now it's time to define the container configuration under this spec file. Since this is an Nginx example, so we are going to deploy Nginx container from Docker Hub. The name of the container we define here is Nginx container. And the image we are using here is Nginx. Since we are not giving any specific Nginx version, so it is going to download and install the latest version of Nginx. Under the image, we can give the environment variables for this container and commands to run when the container is started if needed. But we are skipping that step. So that's all it is. It's very simple and straightforward. So once you deploy this config, it will create one instance of Nginx container inside your Kubernetes cluster. And now let's go ahead and deploy this pod configuration inside our Kubernetes cluster. In this slide, we'll create, display, and verify pod object. Since our Nginx pod manifest file is ready, let's go ahead and deploy that pod. To do that, we use kubectl create command, which is followed by the name of the pod, which is nginxpod.yaml. and the output confirms that pod is successfully created. Next, to verify the pod is running or not, we'll use a kubectl get pod. So it will list all pods inside your Kubernetes cluster. So in case if you want to display the specific pod, we can use the pod name after kubectl get pod. As you can see, pod status is successfully running and there are no restarts, and it has been 2 minutes since it is created. As we know, every pod has a unique IP address. So to know the IP address of a pod in the node which this pod is running, we need to print the void output of it. We can do that by using kubectl get pods followed by void option. As you can see, pod has the IP address of 10.240.1.26 and it is running on node 1. And next cool feature about kubectl get command is it can print the object configuration in YAML or JSON format. So let's print our pod config in YAML format. To do that, we just add YAML option at the end of the kubectl get pod command. And you can see the YAML format of the pod object that we just created. So this is how we create the pod object and display higher level details of pod. So next, we'll see how to display the detailed output of Nginx pod in next slide. Kubectl describe will display all the details of the pod, which includes list of all events from the time pod is assigned to the node till the current status of the pod. Now, to display the details of our Nginx pod, we'll run the kubectl describe pod command followed by the pod name, which in this case, Nginx pod. As you can see from the output, it will print the name of the pod, node on which pod is running currently, when it started, labels of this pod, current status which is running, then the pod IP, and finally list of all events of Nginx pod. This command comes very handy during troubleshooting. Next, we'll perform some basic testing to make sure pods are accessible in next slide. Here, we'll verify if the connectivity from the master node to the pod is working or if there are any issues. For that, we need the pod IP. You can get that from kubectl describe command or kubectl get command that we just saw. In our example, pod IP is 10.240.1.26. So let's ping that pod IP. As you can see, connectivity between the master node and the pod is working perfectly alright. Next, let's get inside the pod and execute some commands. For that, we need to get the shell prompt. And here is a command. Here, -it is the command that refers to the interactive shell, and the type of shell need is bash sh. So after you run this command, now we are inside the pod. So let's find out the host name of it. As you can see, Nginx pod is the host name. Now, to get outside of this pod, we'll use the exit command. Finally, let's delete this pod that we just created. For that, we'll use the kubectl delete command. As you can see from the output, the pod has been successfully deleted. So far in this video, we have created the pod manifest file, then we displayed, then tested, and finally deleted. So before we end this video, let's recap all the things that we just discussed in this video so far. Coming to the summary, in part 1, we discussed the concepts around Kubernetes. First, we discussed what is pod in Kubernetes. So pod is the atomic unit of deployment in Kubernetes, just like similar to VM in virtualization and containers in containerized world. Then we discussed about how we deploy pod and scale it as per the demand increases. After that, we discussed about what is multi-container pod and its purpose. Then we discussed about pod networking. As I mentioned, every pod inside Kubernetes has their unique IP address. Containers inside the pod share the same IP address as pod IP. Containers are exposed to the outside world on its ports. After that, we discussed about the inter-pod networking. It is a communication between two pods. As we discussed, every pod IP address is routable inside the cluster. Then, we discussed about intra-pod networking, where two or more containers inside the pod communicate with shared local host. So, all these containers within the same pod share same common IP address, volumes, network namespace, and IPC. After that, we discussed about various states in lifecycle of pod. So as soon as the pod is scheduled on the worker node, then pod will be in pending state. Then it will move into the running and finally succeed at state. So if the pod has any issues starting during the pending state, it will move into the failed state. And that's about the part 1. And coming to the part 2, we first discussed about the pod manifest file. Then we created the pod and displayed it and validated the objects to make sure it has created successfully. And after that, we tested the pod deployments to make sure it is working as it should be. And yes, it did. And finally, we deleted the pod object that we just created. Now, moving on to the next video, which is actual demo of pods on live Kubernetes cluster, where we will perform the exact steps that we just discussed in review demo section. So a link to that video is provided in the description below. And finally, thank you so much for watching this. Hope to see you in the next video.